AI, the way it works, if you think about it, it's about data that you input into an algorithm, and then you get an output. And most of the data is biased. So by definition, if you input biased data, you'll get a biased output. So if we don't incorporate, you know, women's vision into those algorithms and those data, they will still be biased and we'll get a biased output.
Greetings, I'm Mike Hill and you're watching Futurist World, your home for big ideas about the future and how to shape the world of tomorrow. Today is going to be woke, because we're catching up with the feminist author, speaker and futurist, Narjis Hilale, on the future of artificial intelligence. With 15 years global expertise in strategy and insights, Narjis is a global citizen, having grown up in Morocco, Switzerland and Indonesia, studying in France and Canada, and working in Singapore, Morocco and France. We met with Narjis in Geneva, where she's an adjunct professor, to discuss her passion for artificial intelligence and its impact on society. So get ready to examine your biases and buy into a new deal. And remember to keep your finger on the pulse by subscribing to our podcast at Futurist.world. Narjis, great to have you here in Geneva. Thank you for joining me.
Thank you, Mike, for having me.
Okay, artificial intelligence. Let's just take it right back to the start. What is AI?
AI, it's so many things, actually. And it's very interesting because the definition has been evolving so much. And it is the future. We don't know what the future will bring. But what we know for sure is that AI is definitely changing today and will be changing our futures in ways that we don't even consider today.
Fantastic. And I think your thought leadership in this area that really grabbed my attention was around how gender neutral or not AI is. Can you tell me a bit more about that?
That's interesting because we see today a lot of initiatives, you know, on gender equality, on women empowerment, on having more women into a key leadership position, into the workplace, etc. That's great, and we need to keep on striving and supporting those initiatives. AI, the way it works, if you think about it, it's about data that you input into an algorithm, and then you get an output. And most of the data is biased, so by definition, if you input biased data, you'll get a biased output.
And tell me a bit more about how it's biased. Like, what sort of bias comes into that data?
If we step back a little bit and we think about the big companies, the GAFAM, so Google, Apple, Facebook, Amazon, Microsoft, that are working with those data, etc., they are owned and led by men. Then you also have the STEM fields, so science, technology, engineering, and math, that are still dominated by men. You have a lot of women and young girls entering those fields and a lot of initiatives also happening so that we support them, but it's still not enough. Mm-hmm. So if we don't incorporate, you know, women's vision into those algorithms and those data, they will still be biased and we'll get a biased output.
So what does that mean in terms of the output? You talked about the input, but if we have bias coming in, what does that mean for the world beyond the AI?
So the thing is that the issues that we're trying to fix today, in 20, 30, 40 or 50 years from now, we'll be in the same situation. We'll still need to fix the issues. Let me probably go a little bit backwards and I can give you an example of the first generation of airbags. It actually killed more women than it saved because they were designed by men. The engineers team that developed them, they developed them, designed them and tested them on the average male body. So those are the things that are happening if you incorporate biased data into the algorithm, you automatically get a biased output.
Is there anything more to that part of the puzzle, the future-proofing society so that we are building equality into these machines so that they can help us in the future?
Oh, that's an interesting point. I mean, I have an interesting view, probably more of a dystopian view, you know, of how the machines are going to help us. And it's interesting because today we talk a lot about women and men, you know, when we talk about equality. But I believe personally that soon we'll be talking about humans and robots. So men and women are going to be in the same situation. And it's interesting because one very famous thought leader, you know, Ray Kurzweil, in his theory of the law of accelerated returns, he's explaining it very well, because he's explaining that technology is evolving exponentially, and our brain is actually used to more of a linear evolution. And the thing is that we, as humans, tend to overestimate basically the impact and of those changes, the changes of the technology, in the short term. But in the long run, we underestimate them, because the curve goes like that.
Yes.
So that's the situation I believe we're in. And if I may just add one more point, you know, if you look at the market capitalization, in 2008, the top 10 publicly traded companies, they were petrol, you know, banks and FMCGs, like PetroChina, Exxon, etc. Today, it's the GAFAM. So we could say that data is kind of the new oil, but who owns the data and who controls the data is actually owning the future.
Yeah, that's right. So how do you feel about that? How do we protect ourselves in a world where data is such a key commodity?
I think it's, first of all, the first point is not even about protecting ourselves, but just being aware of it. Because that's one of the issues I see, is the fact that people underestimate the impact, because it's easing our daily life. You know, it's so user friendly. Yes. It's helping us every day, and you cannot go against it, you know. But it's just, if you are aware of what you're giving, you know, the part of yourself that you're giving in exchange for this service or this tool or this app, this is the first step. And I believe that a lot of people are not aware, you know, of basically all the information that they're providing freely.
Who's got time to read those terms and conditions? Is this informed consent? Do we know what we're getting ourselves into?
Not really.
Do we need a new system for consent?
I believe we need to look at it, you know, and try to understand where we as humans, you know, are standing, and how, and again, who owns the data, who collects it, and who controls it. Because that's the thing, we are giving a part of ourselves, but we don't know tomorrow what's gonna be done with it.
Yes. So we have men and women on one side, and we have robots or AI on the other side, and you have a dystopian view. What is the future of AI? How do you see it playing out?
So AI is the future, and yeah, I have a dystopian view. I think nobody knows what's going to happen. But what is important is that we try to prepare ourselves, and our kids as well, the next generation, at least to have kind of a critical mindset, so that we just don't accept things as they come, because it's free, because it's easy, because it helps us in our daily life. But what do we, you know, what's behind it? What's the counterpart? I think it's about awareness, about also looking at things differently, but also challenging ourselves, because we tend to rely on what we know, what we learn. We go to school, okay, and then we go to university, and then you get a diploma, and then you go to work, and that's it. Tomorrow, it's not gonna be like that. Actually, today, it has already changed. It's going to be challenging ourselves constantly, learning constantly. We need to change our mindset. And not be scared of the change, but more embrace it, because it's happening anyways. And we need to look at the educational system as well. Is it obsolete? And should we focus more on the soft skills rather than the hard skills that everybody relies on? Even if you look at a resume, you only talk about your hard skills. You very rarely, you know, put forward your soft skills.
Yeah. And I think this really occurs to me as a futurist, you are in another group of people where there's gender imbalance. There are far more men who are in this field of futurism than women. Is there a role for more women to get into this and possibly even a feminist perspective on the future?
I think everybody will benefit, you know, of having more of an equal view and equal, let's say, conversations, because this is definitely what's missing. Today, women, according to the World Bank, we only have 3/4 of the legal rights that men have, you know, be it in terms of access to jobs, access to loans, land ownership, etc. So I think it is not a threat. It is beneficial for everybody. It's not someone or something that will replace something else. I think we need to work it together because we're all humans. And again, the future, it's humans and robots. So let's, you know, hold hands together and work it together so that we can make sure that it's more of an equal world tomorrow.
Do you think AI can be a force for good, allowing a sort of leapfrog effect so that equality can happen faster?
As it is growing today, I'm not really sure. I know that there are initiatives as well done to kind of neutralize, you know, the biases in AI, but they're still very minor because at the end, we are taking data, previous data. It's data that happened already, that we that are already available. And those data are definitely biased. So there's still a lot of work to be done. Again, I'm quite pessimistic, you know, about the future if we keep on working as we are working today. I think we need to keep on raising the awareness first that AI is coming, you know, it's already here, and it will be changing, you know, tremendously the world as we know it. But at the same time, it's coming fast. And let's make sure we start thinking of reshaping it, you know, rather than trying to fit the world of today.
So when you think about the future, is there anything in science fiction or popular culture that inspires you or terrifies you?
Yeah, inspires me and definitely terrifies me. So, of course, the classic references like George Orwell, 1984, Fahrenheit 451, Space Odyssey, 2001. The thing is that I also have modern references like Black Mirror. I'm a fan of Black Mirror, the Netflix series, because it's totally dystopian, definitely. But what is very interesting is that we see some of the episodes happening today, like what's happening in China with the social credit system. This is definitely the replica of one of the episodes. So it is frightening because actually reality surpasses fiction. And then you have on the other side, this kind of space race or space quest, you know, of Elon Musk with SpaceX and Jeff Bezos with Blue Origin and Richard Branson with Virgin Galactic. The thing is that we live in this world today, and it's about the future where a minority, you know, will be actually living, you know, and surviving into space. But can we try to fix the world today? Okay, yes, the future is going to be about data and who will own it, you know, will control the future. But it's about today, you know, the world we're living in and the earth we're living in as well.
We're talking about the future of AI. When you think about this, what is the future of AI looking like from your standpoint?
So AI is the future. The future of AI is actually connected to data, to me, to who owns and controls those data, are the ones who are going to own and control the future. The future of AI is something that I believe we already have wrote. You know, the book is already half written, but I think we can still change the outcome in the sense that if we keep on raising the awareness and make sure that people understand the pace at what it is going and the impact, you know, that it is having and it will still have on our lives, I think that that raising the awareness will help also change our mindsets, because at the end we need to change our mindsets, you know, to make sure we have a kind of equal and beneficial and human type of AI.
It's really refreshing having a female futurist on the show. Thanks for being part of this. For those women and girls watching this, you know, what's your message to them? What would you like to see in terms of their participation in conversations like this?
I think that they need to believe in themselves. You know, that's the first thing. And never let anyone put you down. I think the world will challenge you. Everything is challenging. But if you believe in yourself and in what you want to do, you can go for it and you'll reach it. So go for it and never, never, ever challenge yourself or believe that you're not going to make it. You can make it.
On that note, thank you, Narjis, for being part of Futurist World.
It was a pleasure. Thank you for having me.
And that's a wrap on the future of artificial intelligence. But before you go, I need you, because we're here to make a change, but we need your help to do it. The whole purpose of this series is to move humanity forward, think bigger, and cast our minds into the future. So we'd love to know, what made the biggest impression on you from today's conversation? Was it the bias that underpins artificial intelligence? Or maybe the knob end asking the questions? Or maybe it was the discussion around a dystopian tomorrow? Come on, share your thoughts, because the best conversations happen right now. So please get involved, share the love, and leave a comment below. And another great place to join the conversation and find more stunning content, of course, is at futurist.world. And when you're there, be sure to sign up for access to exclusive content and awesome giveaways, including Narjis's book, The Woman's Essential Box for the Corporate World. And you can also find us on all the usual social platforms via the links below. So thanks again for joining us. The future is out there, and I look forward to seeing you next time on Futurist World.